We are coming up here on the half hour of Open Line. First of all, thank you once again for joining us. I'm Carrie Sharp. Tonight we are talking with Dr. William Schaffner from Vanderbilt about infectious disease, and that includes COVID. It includes monkeypox. We're going to do polio and also the flu. And of course, this is Open Line. This is a chance for you to ask your questions of an expert. 615-737-PLUS is the number to call. We've already had some great callers. We always appreciate them. Dr. Schaffner, we appreciate you being with us tonight and lending your wisdom. Let's continue this conversation about monkeypox. We talked a little bit about the vaccine. Tell me more about it and how it works and what people can expect.
Well, Carrie, it's a very effective vaccine. It provides about 85% effectiveness. We're giving it now. I should tell you, it's given by injection, the way a conventional vaccine is given. And it's a two-dose series separated by 3 weeks or longer. Now, at the moment, I said we didn't have enough vaccines, so the national strategy is to give as many people as possible the first dose and hold off on the second. That second dose is useful to give you long-term protection, but the notion is as more vaccine comes in, we can open up the doors and get everybody in a little later for their second dose, because we want to give as many people as possible the protection that we can get from the first dose. So that's our national strategy at the moment.
So, you know, we just started hearing about monkeypox here in the U.S. just really a couple of weeks ago. And it just reminds a lot of people, I think, kind of nervously so, the same way we heard about COVID. You know, it hit out west first. It was a nursing home. There's one or two cases, and then it started multiplying. And here we are with monkeypox. So you have described very different scenarios of how it is transmitted. But I'd like you to pull out that crystal ball of yours, get it warmed up. Where do you think that we are going with this monkeypox? I mean, I don't think we're not calling it a pandemic. Where are we going with this?
Well, the virus is going to tell us. We're working still very hard to get our arms around this epidemic, to try to define each and every case, make sure that they get the treatment that they need, and then find those persons' contacts so we can check them out and, if necessary, ask them to go into a period of quarantine for a while. That is our very best approach while we're also getting as much vaccine into the population that's most affected, doing all those things simultaneously. Now, Carrie, you know I'm a pretty optimistic fellow,
yep.
But what I'm going to say now is a bit cautious. Monkeypox is still spreading throughout the United States, and I hope we're still not there, but we're close to what I call the tipping point. At a given point, we may not get our arms around this epidemic, and monkeypox could become part of our society the way other illnesses are that are transmitted through sexual intimacy. Gonorrhea, syphilis, chlamydia, herpes, we have a whole series of them. Monkeypox could become one of them, one of those diseases, and affect potentially a much larger variety of people than it's currently affecting. So everybody in public health is still working to get their arms around this monkeypox epidemic and pull it back and try to tamp it down.
And I want to take about 100 steps back here. Why now? We haven't had to talk about this for so very long. What has happened that has allowed this to creep back in?
Well, what's happened with COVID and monkeypox and polio, and of course each year influenza, is that the world is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. What's over there can be over here. It's just a plane ride away. And there are more people traveling faster around the world. And these viruses can hitchhike on all those travelers and be transmitted around the world. Think about COVID. It began in a city in China that was interior to China. I have to tell you, I did not know the name of Wuhan until I encountered COVID. My ignorance, but I just did not know that. Within about a month, this virus had been transmitted to every continent in the world, with the possible exception of Antarctica. So you can see how quickly a highly contagious virus can move around the world. What this does mean is that I don't care how interior to the country we are, and we Tennesseans are interior. I don't see any ocean around us. We're in the middle of our country, but we are close to many countries around the world. We cannot take just a US-centric view. We have to have a global sense of what's going on. We have to do surveillance. We have to keep looking about what's happening around the world and then respond to those things in order to prevent our own population from becoming affected or to diminish that risk. Mm-hmm. We're in a large world. We can't back out alone and kind of jump into a hole and draw the top in afterwards. Those years are long past.
You mentioned polio, which of course is a whole different ball of wax than what we've been talking about. But again, it is creeping back into our news cycle and our society.
So polio is another example of what I've just said. It was an imported infection from another part of the world. It got into a population just outside of New York City, a very conservative religious group that doesn't really vaccinate its children and its population thoroughly at all. They are very vaccine resistant, even not even hesitant, but resistant. This is the same population that had a big outbreak of measles years ago. If we leave people here unvaccinated, that's a potential target for viruses that are imported from abroad, and then they can spread in that population. Now, the vast majority of the U.S. population is well vaccinated against polio. We eliminated polio. We eliminated polio not only from the United States, but the whole Western Hemisphere. But if we don't continue to vaccinate, 4 million children are born into the United States each year. We have to vaccinate each and every one of them each year in order to keep our protection up. If we allow pockets of parents withholding their children from vaccination, which is happening in our country, that's a potential location for the importation of diseases we thought we had eliminated, but are still active around the world. Oh dear, I've said it again. We have to have a global approach. We have to keep our protection of all of us up. We're all in this together, and it is a very small world.
And let's talk about flu, because it's just about that season again where flu peaks. You know, I think people to some extent are weary of just talking about one virus after another after another. You know this, and I'm sure you get a little weary too, even though this is your life's work. But the flu is here. It's always been here. What do we need to keep top of mind?
So, Carrie, the first thing I have to assure you of, I don't get weary of talking about vaccines.
Well, I stand corrected.
Or viruses. But I think the average person does have some viral and vaccine fatigue.
Yeah.
But I'm going to be talking about it again. Yes, in addition to COVID, we're very COVID-focused, obviously, there's another seasonal virus, a respiratory virus that shows up each year, and that's influenza. Sometimes we have easy seasons. Sometimes we have really fiercely bad seasons. We have a vaccine against influenza. The recommendation as to who should get vaccinated each year could not be simpler. If you're older than 6 months of age, you should get your annual flu vaccine. So this fall, you'll hear me say it again, roll up one sleeve and get your flu vaccine. Roll up your other sleeve, because we have an updated COVID vaccine for you that we anticipate will be available. So this year, it'll be a double-barreled shotgun, but very important.
I know there was talk at one time, and I don't know, you'll know the latest, I'm sure, of combining that COVID and flu vaccine, if people are interested, that maybe that would be in the works someday and just make it easier.
See, Carrie, you are a vaccine scientist, because they have been working on that. They won't have it ready this year, but the gleam in the scientist's eye is, maybe next year we'll have a combined flu updated, a combined COVID updated vaccine, and we can go back to just raising up, rolling up one sleeve and get a double dose from that one vaccination. We're far from that yet, but I have my fingers crossed.
Good. Let's talk about these tests that people can do at home. It seems everybody's got some stuffed away in their cabinet somewhere just in case they start feeling some symptoms. And of course, I just want to make clear I'm talking about COVID now. What is your opinion on these at-home tests versus a PCR test? What should people know and what should people be doing?
Well, if you don't expect perfection, you won't be disappointed. These at-home tests are another miracle of modern science. We didn't even know about COVID vaccine, and now we have diagnostic tests that we can do at home and get a really pretty accurate result in 15 minutes. Outstanding. I would never have anticipated that. Now, those tests are very good. They're not as accurate as that fancier PCR test that has to be sent away and you have to wait 3 days. So obviously the great advantage of the COVID test is it's quick and you can do it at home. Now, those tests are not quite as precise as the PCR. So the general recommendation, and the Food Drug Administration has said this just in the last several days, if you're exposed, wait 5 days. If you do it too early, it's likely to be negative. You have to give the virus enough time to multiply in your nose. Check on day 5. If you're negative, great, but check it again the next day. And if you're negative, hooray, that's really wonderful. So multiple testing gives you a greater sense of assurance that the test is really going to be very precise and accurate. So they have terrific advantages, but they're not exactly perfect. But then hardly any test we use in medicine is perfect.
Can we talk about our own body's immune system when it comes to these infectious diseases, particularly COVID, and maybe how our immune systems have adapted since March of 2020 and how that kind of plays into everything now?
Well, you're exactly right. It's so different now than it was a year and a half ago, because our immune systems didn't have experience of this virus at all, and we were what we call in medicine susceptible. Our bodies were ready to catch this virus, and the virus could make us very, very sick. Over the period of the last year and a half or two, so many people have experienced the infection. Well, that gives them a degree of protection, a degree of immunity. Many people have gotten the vaccine. That also gives them protection. Some people have had both. Actually, that gives you a double dose of protection. So the level of protection in our population now is so much better. And that accounts in large measure for the striking drop in hospitalizations. You remember when this started, our hospitals could barely cope with the onslaught of really sick patients. That's really diminished. There are people who are still at risk of serious disease. Permit me to mention them. People who are unvaccinated. We have a lot of such souls in Tennessee. Number two, people who are not completely vaccinated. So please keep up, get your vaccine up to date. Number three, even though they've been vaccinated, older people, particularly advanced age, and those who have underlying illnesses, any kind of heart disease, lung disease, diabetes, and of course, anyone who has any sort of immune compromise, you and your doctor know who you are. All of those people are at greater risk of having the vaccine not be perfectly effective in them. So they should be particularly careful in how they go about, the crowds that they're in, and yes, those people should wear their masks when they're in, particularly indoors in crowds. Those masks, they really do give you another layer of protection.
Okay, we're going to take another quick break, then we'll come back and answer any more questions you may have. Go ahead and give us a call now, 615-737-PLUS. Stay with us.